Church, we're so excited that you're here. We're ready to worship the Lord with you this morning. Would you stand? We're going to sing together about the great things our Lord has done for us.
You guys can be seated for just a moment. We're going to take a few minutes to remind ourselves of the great things God is doing in our midst. You know, it's amazing to me as you look back over the course of our lives that God's fingerprints are all over our lives. What a beautiful truth that is. He is truly done and is doing and will continue to do great things in our midst. So we worship the God who is able this morning. We set our hearts on Him. We lift up praise to Him today. I'm reminded that he invites us to also participate in those great things that he does through our serving, through our giving, through our worship. All over this campus this morning, folks are participating in God doing great things. So we celebrate that as well. What a privilege it is to be a part of what God is doing in our midst. And I want to remind us of a few things this morning, and we want to pray for a few things that relate to great things God is doing. First of all, we are right in the middle of collecting our Annie Armstrong Easter offering. 100% of that offering goes to support North American missions all across this nation, helping keep missionaries, church planters on the field, doing what God has called them to do. God is doing great things through their efforts, and we want to partner with that in our giving. Another thing, as I think about being on the field, we've got a team right now in Provo, Utah. This is the heart of Mormonism, a very dark place, and six folks from Richland Creek went there last night. They're safely there. They're worshiping there this morning, even as we are here. They're being trained, and tomorrow they hit the ground going to college campuses, sharing the light of Christ. And so we want to support them, and as we might say, hold the ropes in prayer for this team in Provo, Utah. In just a couple of weeks, we have another team going to Albania that will serve alongside some of our partners there to encourage them as they are there on the field all the time and need that encouragement, but they'll also be taking the gospel forward. And so in your worship guide, I brought this up here on purpose today, in your worship guide, you will see some prayer prompts that you can remember this Provo team through the week and the Albania team as we walk up towards April 13th and their departure and their time there in Albania. We want to partner with them in prayer. Again, church family, God is doing great things, and as we partner in prayer, he uses us to stir up the supernatural and bring himself glory. So guys, let's go together in prayer this morning for those teams and for God to stir in our midst as well. Father, we love you because you first loved us. We are thankful for the great things you've done in our lives. You caused dead men and women to come alive in Christ. We're thankful for that. And Lord, as we send these teams out, we know that you've called us to be your witnesses, your ambassadors. And so we're thankful for these teams that would go and take that command seriously. And Father, as they go to support and encourage partners, we ask that you would just bear fruit through their efforts. Lord, the partners that are on the field, they might be discouraged. Lord, they might be facing hardships that we can't imagine. And so we pray that these teams would breathe life into them, so to speak. Lord, we also pray for the gospel conversations that will happen. We pray now in advance for hearts, for lives that you already know are going to hear the gospel, that you, O Lord, would draw them to yourself. Prepare their hearts now that it would be fertile soil, that when the gospel seed falls, it would take root and grow, and again, Lord, bring you glory. Father, that's our desire here this morning as well, is to bring you glory as we worship, as we praise you, as we seek you in prayer. We declare our dependency on you, and Lord, we sit under the preaching of your word, and all those things we desire to see you glorified in our lives. So Father, we give you this morning, we give you our praise, we give you our lives. We pray this all in Christ's name, amen. Guys, if you would, please stand with us as we continue to lift our voices to the Lord.
There's peace that outlasts darkness, hope that's in the blood. There's future grace that's mine today, that Jesus Christ has won. So I can face tomorrow, for tomorrow's in your hands. All I need you will provide, just like you always have. I'm fighting a battle you've already won.
In Christ. Let's sing this because we know it to be true.
I know how the story ends. We will be with you again.
One day.
You're my Savior, my defense. No more
because you know. Church. Amen. It's a big song. We serve a bigger God. Amen. So we did this in the first service. Sometimes I fear that on a Sunday morning you've rushed in here and it's easy to sort of get past the songs. And then we hear the message and then we're like, man, I wish I had heard that before I sang the songs, because sometimes we just forget the gospel. It's called gospel amnesia. We forget some truth. We just sang this. And sometimes we're debating, do I really believe this? Do I really feel like I've already won in Christ? Is that true? Because my life doesn't reflect that truth, right? And so I want to give you a chance to do the most important thing we can do right now, and that's pray. So if you will, just have a seat. And we're about to sing a song about the mercy of God in a minute. But I want us to experience the mercy of God. It's true. It's alive. It's active. God wants to speak to your heart today. We need to confess our sin. We need to say to the Lord, thank you for your mercy. We need to receive the mercy. Say, God, I take this mercy. The free gift that you're giving to me, I humble myself and I receive it. And then we can give mercy to others because we have experienced the mercy of God. The gospel of Jesus is true, and we need to believe that today. And so just take a moment and pray however the Lord leads you, but pray, Lord, give me a heart to receive your mercy and to extend mercy to others. Take a moment and pray in that direction. God, we thank you for the mercy you showed us through Christ, and we're so excited to be in this season where we're going to hear messages about the Christ, Jesus, the one and only. Lord, I pray that our hearts would be changed today as we consider your word, as we consider how you revealed yourself to us through Christ, how you demonstrated your love through Christ. And I pray for my brothers and sisters, if anybody is struggling to believe and to receive the love that you're offering, Lord, I pray that, God, you would turn our hearts to you and away from the pride of thinking that we know better than you. God, we know that you've already won the victory in Christ. Lord, we know this. Lord, in our head, I pray it would just travel to our hearts today. God, that we would believe fully and receive fully the mercy and grace that you have for us today. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's stand together and let's sing this song about the mercy of God.
I will kneel in the dust at the foot of the cross where mercy paid for me. Where the wrath I deserve, it is gone, it is past, your blood has hidden me.
Thank you, God.
Mercy.
hearts would be drawn to you. Lord, we know you want to draw us closer to yourself today. And so, Lord, we pray for Pastor Mike as he opens your word, your holy word, and speaks about the greatest person who ever lived, our Savior, King Jesus. God, I pray our hearts would not be indifferent. God, that we'd be moved by the mercy and the grace that you have shown us. God, that we would walk in that. We pray in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Church, thank you for singing with us. Be seated, please.
Well, good morning, church family. If you have your copy of God's Word with you today, would you turn to Luke chapter 9? I want to say good morning to all of you today. I want to say hola, familia querida. Doy gracias a Dios por sus vidas as well. For those who are listening in Spanish today as well, I hear a clap every time I say a little bit of Spanish. It's like you're amazed that it happens. I feel that in my heart as well. So. But good morning to all of you today. Thankful you're choosing to join us as we jump into this series looking at the Lord Jesus Christ. And so, like I said, if you'll turn to Luke chapter 9, if you have your copy of God's Word, we'll look at the end of that chapter today. But I do want to remind you of a couple things. We're coming up on time to walk through another season of Discover Richland Creek. You'll see at the end of our service today, those who have followed through this process and are joining, they're members of our church now. You'll see that at the end of our services today. But we have a class called Discover Richland Creek that is designed for those who are new and want to learn more about our church. And maybe it's your first Sunday or you've been coming here for a little bit of time. And I know this is a big room. It's easy to come in here, maybe sit in the corner. You can slide in and out without really connecting with the body of our church. And this is a good next step for you. And if you choose so, at the end of the class, you don't have to, but you walk through these 4 weeks, you learn about our church, and at the end, if you choose to join the fellowship of Richland Creek, you can do that at the end of those 4 weeks. In fact, you'll see many of the ones who, at the end of our service today, who have chosen to take that step. So that begins April 16th. It's a four-week class. It meets at 9 o'clock hour on Sundays. We're also offering on April 1st an offering in Spanish now. So if you'd like to walk through the Spanish version of the class, you can do that. You can reach out to Ricardo, who leads our Hispanic ministry. And so we would love to have you to join us for that. And if you would like to be a part of the class here, you can go to our website and sign up online to make sure we have a place for you. The second thing I want to mention is we're gathering for prayer tonight, 6 o'clock, for our night of prayer. We're just spending, we come together once a month to pray as a church. We'd love to have you join us right here in this room, 6 p.m. tonight. And we're going to be talking about when the Lord says, ask me anything, when he opens up this prayer for you to be able to bring any request to him, what does that look like for us as believers? How do we bring every request to the Lord? We'll be walking through some time of prayer in that regard. Now, before we read Luke chapter 9, I want to do a little bit of background work. I want you to know what we're reading before we read it. And the book of Luke is broken up into sections. Most of us are familiar with the first couple chapters. We hear it every year at Christmas, talking about the wise men and the shepherds and Jesus' birth. And so the Gospel of Luke begins with that picture. From that point on, from chapters 3 to 9, really, up till this verse 51, the Gospel of Luke is speaking about Jesus' ministry here on the earth. And oftentimes we think of Jerusalem, and it really is, the center part of Jesus' ministry. That's where he'll be crucified, he'll be buried, he'll be raised, he'll ascend to the Father. All of that occurs in Jerusalem. But if you were to look on a map, a lot of Jesus' ministry occurs in what we would call the region of Galilee. If you know your Bible, you'll hear terms, the Sea of Galilee, all this area up north, Nazareth, where he's from, is up north of Jerusalem. So much of his ministry occurs up north of where Jerusalem is. And so here Jesus reaches a point, and the verse we'll read today actually marks an entire section of the book of Luke. So from chapter 9, verse 51, all the way to chapter 19, where we'll be next Sunday with Palm Sunday, All of that section is this focus on Jesus and his mission and going toward Jerusalem. You'll hear it in the text as we read it today. So if you have your copy of God's Word open to Luke 9, would you please stand in honor of the reading of his Word? As you do that, we'll read verse 51 through verse 56. And like I said before, this verse 51 marks a new direction or a different focus in the ministry of Jesus. So beginning Luke chapter 9, verse 51, the Word of God says, "Now when the days drew near for him to be taken up, he set his face to go to Jerusalem. He sent messengers ahead of him who went and entered a village of the Samaritans to make preparations for him. But the people did not receive him because his face was set toward Jerusalem. When his disciples, James and John, saw it, they said, "Lord, do you want us to tell fire to come from heaven and consume them?" But he rebuked them. He turned and he rebuked them, and they went on to another village. Let's go to the Lord in prayer today. Heavenly Father, we know you suffered, you died, you rose again, and now, Lord, you sit, Lord Jesus, you sit at the right hand of the Father. Thank you, Lord, for doing this, to save us. We're thankful today, as we just sang, for the mercy of God that is found in your Son, Jesus Christ, and it's in his name we pray, amen. You may be seated. I'll ask you today, what's the longest road trip, car ride, you've ever taken? Was it for a day or 2 days, 1,000 miles, 2,000 miles? Maybe it was a couple hours. If a couple hours is your longest road trip, you are a blessed person. Maybe you've driven across country from coast to coast. And if you've ever done it as either a child or in a car with children, we've all experienced everyone's favorite question. How much longer, right? When are we going to get there? Are we ever going to get there? The modern world, I don't know if I hear it as much anymore. Now the children can just go on their phone and type it in the GPS and not ask mom or dad anymore. But ultimately, you get on a long car ride like that, or maybe a long plane ride. It maybe takes a couple days. It feels like it's long. You start to ask, will I ever make it on this journey? Will we ever finally get there? Well, the Lord Jesus here in Luke chapter 9 has been on a long journey, and now it's going to be 10 chapters worth of Luke. He's about to turn his face to Jerusalem. Look at verse 51. We'll read it several times today. But look at it there with you if you got your Bibles. Look what it says. When the days drew near for him to be taken up, he, Jesus, set his face to go to Jerusalem. From this point on in the book of Luke, Jesus turns his focus towards Jerusalem and all that will occur there, and he makes his journey that way. If you read through Luke in your quiet times or personal devotions, you'll see a shift in the gospel here. In fact, just a couple verses later, he'll send a group ahead of him through the Samaritan territory to kind of lead the way there. Chapter 10, verse 1, if you've heard of him sending out the 72 to declare the kingdom of God is at hand, that's what he does after he turns his face towards Jerusalem. Chapter 13 will describe this journey that he's on. Even Luke picks it up in chapter 18. I'll read a couple verses to you. It says, "In talking to the 12, Jesus said to them, 'See, we are going up to Jerusalem.'" Even chapters later, he's saying, we're going to Jerusalem, "and everything that is written about the Son of Man by the prophets will be accomplished. For he will be delivered over to the Gentiles and will be mocked, shamefully treated, spit upon, and after flogging him, they will kill him, and on the third day he will rise." See, from this verse in chapter 9, verse 51, Jesus is a man with a mission from God. And certainly he was sent to earth with this mission, so it's nothing new. But from this point, his eyes, his gaze, his focus is all on Jerusalem. He is set to suffer, die, rise again, defeat death and the grave, and to ascend to the Father's right hand where he sits today. This was all part of the plan of God. And Luke records this mercy-filled journey. And for us today, it's important for us to know that Jesus walked the broken road of this life to give us victory over death. He walked this journey. It's a very clear path that he takes through the Gospel of Luke. He does that so that we might have victory over death. And this journey Jesus is on towards Jerusalem is marked by several things. I want to give you the first way that this journey is marked, if you're taking notes. The road, this road Jesus was on, was part of a map. It was part of a map, a bigger plan. When you look at a map, you understand that road is a part of something bigger going on. You can look at all the things surrounding it. And as Jesus comes to this point in Luke's gospel, we see his life is about fulfilling a much bigger plan than just him going to Jerusalem. Notice the phrase here in verse 51. We'll read it several times, so get used to verse 51. Look at the first phrase, what it says. When the days drew near for him to be taken up. Do you hear the phrase at the beginning? When the days drew near. The days grew full, or they filled up. Like an hourglass. You ever see those? Like a big hourglass, you flip it over and the sand runs to the bottom. And as the timer runs to zero, the sand fills up the bottom of that hourglass. In the same way, as the days draw near to Jerusalem, the prophecies of the Old Testament begin to fill up. And now they're all coming to fruition in Christ himself. He is fulfilling everything that has been said up to this point. You see, Jesus coming to the earth to save his people from their sins is not God's last resort. As a parent, every once in a while, if you have a house that has stairs and two floors in it, you're downstairs, your kids are upstairs, and you give instructions, and they don't listen, and you give instructions again. And then you make the phrase, you say, don't make me come up there, right? Like, you got to go up there and deal with the problem on the second floor. The cross is not like God, some grumpy parent upstairs. He's been yelling down to us the whole time. We're just terribly sinful people. We keep messing it up, and finally God's like, well, I got to go down and deal with the problem. The cross is something that has been planned for thousands of years. You see, this prophecy is being fulfilled in him. The days were filling up. Can you imagine waiting on something? I know we're not ever going to live on the earth in this way this long, but can you imagine they waited for thousands of years for this Messiah? If you were to talk to someone maybe in these days and you would say, we've waited this whole time, all these prophecies, is he really here? I would begin to wonder. I would start to doubt if I had waited that long. You see, they were in a season of seeing that the Lord was going to do what he said he would do. In the same way, I think we sit here today as believers. We sit a couple thousand years removed from when Christ was on the earth. And we look back, and I often wonder sometimes, we think, man, is he ever going to come back? Is it ever going to happen? I long for the day when it talks about Christ's return, and we can say, when the days drew near. When the prophecies, not just of the Old Testament for Christ to come the first time, are fulfilled, but the prophecies about the return of Christ for his people. There is a time. We don't know the time. The Lord didn't tell us when, but there is a time, and there will be a day when the hourglass of the prophecies of the New Testament fill up, and the days draw near, and Christ will return. Oh, how we as believers should long for that day. To want to be, to see Christ on his return. But you see, this Savior, the Lord Jesus, had a destination as well. It wasn't that there was just a map, but Jesus had a place to go. So it's the second thing I want you to see. The road led to a destination, led to a place. You see, the road Jesus was on had a destination. See, the Son of God dying for the sins of the world, like I said a moment ago, wasn't just an afterthought. Even when Jesus is on the earth, God's not like an offensive coordinator up there for the football team going, well, they called this play, now I'm going to call this play. He's not playing some guessing game. God, from the very beginning, has had a plan for how he's going to do this. But the destination here in Luke 9:51 might be different than you think. Most of us think the destination is the cross. That's what Luke might say. The days drew near for Jesus to go to the cross. But look at verse 51. Look at the phrase he uses. When the days drew near for him to be taken up. What does he mean by taken up? Does it mean that he's drawing near so that he might, Jerusalem's on a hill, that he might be taken up to Jerusalem where it's on a hill? I don't think that's it. Does it mean he's taken up when they lift up the cross? I don't believe that's it either. I believe when the writer Luke here is taking this gospel and he's speaking about being taken up, there's another book Luke wrote as well that's his follow-up to this gospel. It's the book of Acts. And in Acts chapter 1, Jesus is what we would say taken up. He's called up. God the Father, we call it the ascension. He heads to heaven where he's at now. So it appears to me that when Luke says the days drew near, the prophecies come to be, it's not just for him to go to the cross, but he has in mind his suffering, his betrayal, his death, his resurrection, and in the end, him rising to the right hand of the Father. You see, the days drawing near are about more than just the cross. They're about the entire work of Christ. Now, certainly, I don't want you to hear me not say this. The cross is central to our faith. The Bible makes it very clear that the cross is what we preach, nothing but Christ crucified. But if we just think about Christ's work on the earth as just the cross, we miss who he is. The work of Christ surrounds the cross. In fact, there's much more to this message of who he is. So I want to mention to you today, I want to recommend a good book. It's just something our pastors finished walking through, and I thought it was a blessing. And I thought of it today as I was preparing the sermon. I'll give you a little warning. It's a little heavier. It's a little stronger in the language. But it's a book called Man of Sorrows, King of Glory. And it's a short read, about 125 pages. But it'll take you a minute to read it. But it walks through all of the work of Christ, through his offices of prophet, priest, and king, all of what he's done. So you'll see even some conversation about his ascension and all those regard in the book. If you forget about it later or want to look it up, my sermon notes are always available online on our website, or just the pointed outline. You can go on there, and the book reference is on there as well if you want to look it up later. But the purpose of this is the thought that the whole arc of what Christ has done is based off of his whole work and not just the cross. In fact, that's why we're taking these 6 weeks, not just leading up to Easter, but 3 weeks after Easter, to look at Jesus. Today we look at this turning of his eyes towards Jerusalem. Next week we'll look at his entrance into Jerusalem on Palm Sunday. Good Friday, we'll think about the cross and how he was crucified and buried. On Easter Sunday, we'll do like we've always done. We'll celebrate the resurrected Lord Jesus. And then we're not done. We'll come back the next week and we'll look at his ascension. How after he rose from the dead, he also ascended to the right hand of the Father. Then we'll take the next week and look at how he's now sitting at the right hand. What is Jesus doing now? You may not realize this, but Jesus has a ministry to you and I right now at the right hand of the Father. And then we'll end this whole 6 weeks looking at the return of Christ and how he will come back for his people. You see, the point here is that when Luke talks about the prophecies of Jesus, he has in mind much more than just the cross. He sees all of his earthly ministry here, all the way up to his ascension. So it's important for us to understand that even though his destination is Jerusalem, we have to understand that it's much more than that. You know, one of the aspects I mentioned earlier about taking a trip, one of the aspects about being a parent that I underestimated was packing for a family trip. Can I get an amen in the room today? Pretty early on, when we had our first child, I realized that packing for a trip edges up on moving. I sometimes think we need to go and rent a truck to go away for a few days. I don't understand why we need all of those things. I feel so light when I travel by myself. I'm packed in about 15 minutes. I believe as a guy, I only need about two pairs of pants, right? One to wear and one as a backup if those get dirty, right? Some of you guys know it's true. We just let the secret out, but it's true. But when you think about packing for a trip, you get everything ready, you get the whole van loaded, you say, I'm headed this direction, and then you get everybody in the car, you pull out your phone, you type in the directions, you hit go, and then you set your focus towards a direction. Now, don't get confused here today. Luke's not confused. Jesus' destination, it was never the cross. He was never destined to stay on the cross. Even though he went to it, even though it was in his path, the cross was only the step towards his glorification. You see, it wasn't just Jerusalem. He knew in Jerusalem that he would be buried, but then 3 days later, on the third day, he would rise again, right? Jesus' destination was never the cross. It was always the right hand of the Father. So, as Jesus starts on this journey, we can also see that he does it with a determination. He has got in his mind, and he is right, that he will complete this journey. Here's the third thing I want you to see. The road that Jesus is on would be completed. He will finish the journey. Oftentimes on a long trip, it's easy to start thinking, will I ever make it there? And as Jesus is going down this road, there was no doubt that he was going to do what he said he would do. So again, back to verse 51, if you got your Bibles there. Let's read the last portion. When the days drew near, so as the prophecies are being fulfilled, for him to be taken up, the ascension on the back end of all that he went through. And then finally, look what it says. He set his face to go to Jerusalem. Here, what is in Jerusalem? It's the cross. It's the tomb. It's the ascension to the Father. He sets his face to go and to do what the Lord has destined him to do. The phrase there, when it says he sets his face, you could translate it. Maybe you have a different translation today. You might have translations that say he determined to go towards Jerusalem. Or he resolutely set out on this journey. There's an intensity to the phrase that when Jesus turns his face to Jerusalem, he is deciding to go to the cross and to rise again one day. Isaiah chapter 50, verse 7, is speaking about the prophet Isaiah. And one of the things about Isaiah is he's a prophet against much opposition. And when the Lord calls him to live out this prophet, this calling as a prophet, he describes this. He says, therefore, I have set my face, and this is what Isaiah says, I have set my face like flint to the task the Lord has given me. He says, I set my face like flint. Flint's a hard rock that can endure much against it. So you imagine Isaiah draws this picture of saying, no matter what I face, no matter what suffering, no matter what opposition, I will succeed in this task. And so just like Isaiah set his face like flint, Jesus seems to pick up these words, or Luke picks up these words. He turns, he looks towards Jerusalem, and he sets his face to the task ahead. Hebrews 12 gives us a window into even more about what Jesus is thinking here. Hebrews 12:2 says, looking to Jesus, the founder and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is seated at the right hand of the throne of God. Do you see the full picture even there of the ascension on the back end? But ultimately, what do you see? You see one who for the joy set before him endured the cross and completed his task. So we know at this point, here's Jesus looking towards Jerusalem, determined to complete the task God has put in front of him. We know that he has a joy set before him. It's the joy of understanding that he will be a part of reconciling God to man. And so he sets his face towards Jerusalem with this divine grit to complete his task. Praise God, we have a Savior who is able to complete the task. That we have one who can do what he says he will do. See, Jesus will do this in spite of those around him that will fail. All the crowds and all the followers. You know, one time Jesus will have thousands of people around him. But as he goes to the cross, the crowds, they fade away. Even his disciples, the 12 closest to him, as he goes to the cross and he sets his mind to the task at hand, Judas, one of the 12, will actually betray him. Even beyond that, he has all this 12, the remaining 11 that seem so excited. The night before, Jesus is praying and they fall asleep. And then there's one, we know about the one, he's pretty exuberant, isn't he? We know about Peter, right? When Jesus says, I'm going to the cross, Peter says, man, I'm going with you. I can do it. I'm right there with you, Jesus. And what happens when Jesus finally goes to the cross? It's just him. One by one, each and every single one of them fall away. One by one throughout the entire Bible, every other person fell away. And out emerges the Lord Jesus who goes to the cross for our sins. He is the only one able to complete the journey. He's the only one able to do what he said he would do. Nothing will stop the Lord Jesus from doing what he says he will do. What an amazing thought for a moment. Like a freight train through history, Jesus will do exactly what he says he will do. No matter the opposition, no matter the people that will come after him. In fact, even those that would crucify him will actually be the means by which he accomplishes his task. It's an amazing thought to think about how Jesus would never falter or fail in the face of opposition. It didn't happen like this, but I imagine Jesus, just for a moment, humor me. If here he wakes up on this day, verse 51, and the sun's coming up, steps outside early morning, he's got his Hebrew coffee out there, just kind of staring off in the distance. He finally looks off to the south, and as he does it, his eyes squint over, right, and he determines, I'm headed to the cross, right? Now, it probably didn't happen that way, maybe in my imagination. But I want to ask you today, what do you think the eyes of Jesus look like in this moment? See, even when the religious leaders attacked him, he didn't fail. Even when one of his closest disciples would betray him, that wouldn't deter Jesus. Even like I mentioned a moment ago, all of his disciples would fail him. That wouldn't stop Jesus. When people wrongly accuse him, Pilate sentences him, he still would succeed. Do you understand that even when they put the nails in the hands of Jesus, they hung him on a cross, they put him in a tomb, that still would not hold back the Lord Jesus from doing what he said he would do? He would rise again and give you and I victory over this broken world. Know today, Jesus will always do what he says he's going to do. So when you see those words, the days drew near for things to be fulfilled, You can know that God does what he says he will do. He'll complete the task at hand. But what is the task of Jesus? What is he about doing? I know for oftentimes we can miss what Jesus is doing. Here's the fourth thing I want you to see. The road, this road for Jesus, was paved with mercy. The road was paved with mercy. You know what was on the mind of Christ? Mercy. He was looking to this destination with great mercy, but his disciples hadn't quite got it yet. So to set the scene, they're up north, like I said earlier. They're headed towards Jerusalem. In between where they're at and Jerusalem is Samaria. Samaritans don't get along with the Jews very well. In fact, he's not going to be welcomed in this Samaritan region. They have a rival temple. They have rival worship. They even have a rival edition of the Pentateuch, the first five books of the Bible. So as Jesus goes through this territory, it's not going to go well. So knowing this, he sends people on ahead of him. So if you got your Bible still open there in front of you, look at verse 52. Verse 52. We're going to move out of verse 51. Look what he says. He sent messengers ahead of him who went and entered a village of the Samaritans to make preparations for him. So he knows it's going to go rough, so he sends people ahead of him. Verse 53, but the people did not receive him because his face was set toward Jerusalem. So why didn't they receive Jesus? It didn't go well. Well, in some ways, I believe this is a precursor to what opposition he'll face in Jerusalem. That'll be the cross and all that happens to him there. But the other half of it is, he might be opposed. He's going to Jerusalem and not their Samaritan place of worship. So here he is on this path, heading through these people that seem to oppose him. So James and John, they're known as the sons of thunder. And so they have a genius idea. Let's read their great idea that we do this sometimes. It's just not good, right? So let's look at what they say in verse 54. And when his disciples, James and John, saw it, when they saw all the opposition, they said, Lord, do you want us to tell fire to come down from heaven and consume them? So James and John have the brilliant idea. They think, well, Jesus, you have these nuclear codes from God. And I know that in the Old Testament, when there was opposition to the prophets of God, that there was Elijah could call down fire from heaven. And we've heard you're greater than Elijah. So how about these people that are in our path, let's just burn them all up. It's quite the idea, isn't it? I can't think of the audacity that they had to say this to Jesus. But then look at verse 55. What does Jesus do? He gets on to him. He turned. So it's almost like he's headed towards Jerusalem. He looks back. You get the sense. And he rebukes them, right? It seems as if these disciples had forgotten what Jesus had taught them. You know, Luke records earlier in his gospel, he'll tell them, love your enemies. Doesn't seem like they've listened to this one. Even on top of that, he'll talk about, blessed are those who are merciful. So Jesus desires to see mercy, and here he is declaring that you need to love your enemies. So I don't know what Jesus said in verse 55. We can only imagine. But he's explaining to them how the kingdom of God works. I'm not going down to Jerusalem to bring war and world domination. I'm going to establish the kingdom of God, which is the church, which is filled with mercy. You see, Jesus came to this world with a mission of mercy. You know, I believe that as followers of Jesus, there are quite a few times that we actually miss Jesus' mission of mercy. I think it's easy for us to look back and think, James and John, what on earth were you thinking? But it's easy for me, and I think us at times, when we live in a world like we do today that people oppose our faith, people will mock Jesus, mock the truth that he gives. And I'm not saying we aren't people who stand on truth, but we're also people of mercy. And Jesus said, love your enemies. You see, those who oppose your faith, they're not your enemies. In fact, they are just objects for the mercy of God to be extended to. I hope you and I don't forget that if you're a believer here today, that there was a day you were an enemy of God. The Bible says that we were all enemies of him, and when Christ died for us, he died for us still as sinners. And you and I have experienced the mercy of God when we were enemies of God. So how much more that when we feel like somebody is the enemy of the truth in our world, should we desire mercy and not judgment on their life? And for Jesus here, as he walks through Samaria, he desires to see mercy extended. Now, a moment ago, I talked about the eyes of Jesus. I want you to go back to that moment, Luke 9:51. I've always been captured by this verse. Captivated by it is what I should say. And he looks. And he looks down to Jerusalem. If you were to see in the eyes of Jesus, what would you see? Have you ever looked in somebody's eyes and they say, I'm going to do this, and you know they're going to do that? You can see determination in somebody's eyes. You think, man, they said it. I believe it. By the way they say it, I can see in their eyes determination. I would imagine when Jesus says, I'm headed towards Jerusalem, there's more determination than you've ever seen in anybody else's eyes in all of history. He was going to do what he said he would do. But I also imagine for a moment that Jesus was looking, and I believe he saw mercy. He was headed down to extend mercy to sinners. You would see love for people who would reject him. Can you imagine what his eyes would have been like? It'll say when he gets to Jerusalem, he'll finally reach his destination. Right before he'll go into the temple, it'll go horribly wrong. It's when he goes in, he flips over the tables. Everything goes really bad when he gets into the temple. And he'll go sit up on the hillside. And you know what he'll do on the hillside? He'll weep. He'll cry over the city that rejects the salvation to be found in him. So what I think you would see in Jesus' eyes that day are determination and mercy. You would see one who would see ahead, they're going to do what they say they're going to do. Now I want to ask you another question. I mentioned earlier that right now Jesus sits at the right hand of the Father. Right now, this moment, interceding on our behalf, advocating for us. What do you think, if you could look in the eyes of Jesus today, what do you think you would see in his eyes today? I believe you would see mercy again. He looks down over our world and sees all kinds of individuals choosing sin, rejecting God. And I believe today Jesus desires to see everyone turn from their sin. It's great joy when a sinner repents of their sin. So you would see mercy and love for people. But I think you would also see the same determination you saw back then. Because, see, He has another destination ahead of him. What did he say? He said, one day I'm coming back. We don't know the day or the hour, but I believe Jesus sits at the right hand of the Father, looking down, believing one day he's going to return. I promise you it's going to happen. The same resolute determination that took him out of the grave to ascend to the Father is the same determination that will bring him back to judge the living and the dead. You see, on that day, when Jesus returns and you look into his eyes, it's either going to be your greatest day of your life or the worst day of your life. If you're a believer here today, on that day you'll be free from sin forever. You'll finally be face to face with your Savior. On that day as a believer, you're going to look at Jesus and worship Him like you never have before. The Bible says He'll wipe away every tear. Oh man, what a moment for us as believers. But the warning of the Bible is if on that day you see the face of Jesus and you have not trusted in the work He's done on the cross, then you'll meet your judge. See, Jesus has promised to come back to judge the earth, to pronounce final judgment on sin, and only those who are found in Christ will experience that grace. So I ask you today, which will it be for you? Don't underestimate Him. I promise you, He's going to do what He said He would do. So you'll either know Him on that day as Savior or judge. Which will it be? Let's go to the Lord in prayer. As we spend a moment in prayer, I just want to ask you, if you were to look in the eyes of Jesus today, what would you see? A merciful Savior? The Bible promises if you'll turn from your sin and place your faith in Jesus today, He can be your Savior. You don't have to wait. You don't have to prepare. There is nothing required of you. In fact, that's actually it. If you think something's required of you before today, then you missed what it is. The gospel says if you'll just turn from your sin and place your faith in Jesus, you will experience the mercy and grace of God. Lord, I pray today that for all of us in here, that we would, when we stand on that day, that we'll stand having placed our faith in You. That on that day we'll experience wonderful mercy and kindness. And so, Lord, today I pray that You would encourage the believers in the room by this glimpse of Your glory. And also, Lord, challenge us for those of us who are not found in Christ. Draw us to You and pray all these things in Christ's name. Amen. It's just a chance. We close our services. This is a time for you to respond to what you've heard today. It's a time for you to sing the praise of God. It's a time for you to give Him honor and glory. If the Lord's dealing with your heart, you think, man, I'm not ready for that. I don't know what the step is. I want to talk to somebody and pray with somebody. You can come down front. Right now, as we sing, you can step down front, talk to one of our pastors or deacons. You can catch us in the lobby at the Next Steps area as well. We'd love to speak with you about your faith in Christ today. So if you would, just stand with us today as we sing, as we respond to the Lord Jesus, what He's done in our life, what He can do in your life today.
We're creation, suddenly articulate. The thousand tongues to lift one cry. From north to south and east to west, we'd hear Christ be magnified. And were the whole earth echoing His imminence, nature finds its inmost melody, and every human heart its native cry. Anyone raptured in praise, will see Christ be magnified. We sing that praise. We sing it all. Christ be magnified. Let his praise arise. Christ be magnified in me. The all. Christ be magnified. The altar.
Church, that's our heart's prayer, right? That Christ would be magnified. Amen. Listen, I'm going to ask you to stay standing for just a few minutes. As you can see, we've got some folks joining us down front here. We're going to do something a little different today. As Pastor Mike said, we're presenting new church members. You'll see their names come up on the screen behind me. But what I'd like to do today is ask for your help. And so what I'm going to ask right now is if you're a church member of Richland Creek, we have these folks down here who are joining our family, and we want you to come pray over them with us. So just go ahead and step out of your seat right now. Come forward. It's okay if you don't know somebody. It's okay if you're not sure who they are. But this is an opportunity for us as a family to come alongside our new brothers and sisters who are members of Richland Creek as we begin to grow in Christ-likeness together. You see, the church is given to us as a gift of God, and we recognize that the gospel is what unites us. It's the shed blood of Jesus that makes us a family. Amen? And so today, we are excited to see these new brothers and sisters join the family of Richland Creek. You see, your pastors have met with them. We've heard their gospel testimony. We're excited to see what God's going to do in their life. But we're even more excited to see how we as a church family are going to be better because they're a part of it. And so as we gather this morning, we remember that it is the gospel alone that has brought us together, and we remember that it is Jesus who saves. Amen? And so what I'm going to ask you to do, for those of you who didn't come down, that's okay. What I would ask you to do, and this is just a little uncomfortable maybe, I'm going to ask you just to stretch out your hand as a way of saying, hey, I want to pray over these brothers and sisters as well, even though I couldn't be down front this morning. And I'm going to pray. And so as I pray, you see their names behind me on the screen. Maybe pick out somebody's name. And as we pray, you pray for them specifically. Join me as we pray. Heavenly Father, we do thank you for each of these new members. We thank you for every family represented here. God, it's our prayer that every new member would pursue godliness and holiness in every area of their life. God, we pray for these before us here who are parents, God, that in the home, Christ would be lifted high. There would be a genuine love for Jesus that is on display every single day. God, we pray for all these members, God, Lord, that as they spend time in your word and as they study it regularly, God, that it would drive their decision-making and that it would change their affections. Father, we pray that they would build meaningful, Christ-exalting relationships within this local body here at Richland Creek. God, that as they are known by other people and as they are challenged to grow in their own personal discipleship, God, that they would welcome accountability so that they can look more like Jesus. Father, we pray that Richland Creek as a church would be strengthened because of their spiritual gift that is going to be used within the different ministries of our church. Father, we ask that you would help each of these to live missionally. God, that they would take the gospel from their neighborhood all the way to the nations. God, we pray that many people would come to faith in Jesus Christ because of their boldness to proclaim the excellencies of the one who called them out of darkness and into his marvelous light. Father, we thank you so much for the gift of the local church. Not a perfect people, but we serve a perfect God who loves us and who sacrificed his son for us. And so, Lord, we thank you that you are a good father and we get to be called your children. You have brought us into your family by grace through faith in Jesus. And so, Lord, we thank you for this blessing of new families being added to our church here at Richland Creek. We look forward to partnering with them in the gospel. Lord, may you protect them, may you guide them, and may you equip them to be your hands and feet wherever you would send them, for your glory and for their good. We thank you for your son, Jesus, and it's in his name we do pray. Amen. Church, would you join me in welcoming these to Richland Creek? And Richland Creek, you are dismissed.